I have an update. NASA has said that there will be a hardware random number generator on the rover that we have access to. And after that, they made one more comment. They reminded me that we just need our algorithm to work in practice. For something to work in practice, it means that there's always some possibility of error, but perhaps the possibility is so small that we ignore it in practice. And if this sounds crazy, just realize that in the physical world, nothing is ever certain. There's always chances for error. For example, chip packaging contains small amounts of radioactive contaminants. And when these decay, they release alpha particles, which can actually flip bits in memory and perhaps change a number unexpectedly. And even more interesting, cosmic rays can also cause soft errors. We can never remove the chance of error completely. And I asked NASA exactly, well, what error probability is acceptable? And they said, we just need to make sure that the probability of error for a given trial is less than the odds of hitting the lottery twice in a row. And the odds of hitting the lottery, say 649 twice in a row, is 6 times 10 to the negative 14. So let's just be safe and round down and say our error probability is 10 to the minus 15. Safe enough. We will not expect to see an error, and it could run hundreds or thousands of times. Now, my question is, would access to randomness help us speed up a decision algorithm, such as this primality test? And this is a deep question, so let's step back and look at the big picture. Given some collection of integers from 1 to some limit n, say, let's think of it as our universe of integers. We can always divide a collection into two sets. And a decision problem can actually be thought of as a partition into two sets. For example, provided some n is n less than 100, it will output yes for all integers less than 100. So here is one collection, and no for all others, which is another collection. Okay, so let's now focus on recognizing primes with a decision. And ideally, what we would like is some simply computed criteria that all primes satisfy and no composites satisfy. Now, if we knew some simple pattern which describes the location of all primes and only primes, then given some number n, we could simply check if n follows that pattern. But the problem is that so far, no exhaustive and simply computed pattern has been found for all primes and no composites, or all composites and no primes. But we do know fast tests for most composite numbers. So, for example, a simply computed criteria would be a test for evenness. And all even numbers are divisible by 2. And it's fast because we can tell if something's even by just looking at the last digit. And even as n grows, the problem doesn't get any harder. We just look at that last digit, also known as the low order bit. Now realize that we can use this evenness test as a low quality composite test, in that we could have some algorithm accept a integer n, and all our algorithm does is check if it's even. If it is even, n greater than 2, then we know with 100% certainty it is composite, because we have proof. Think of 2 as our composite witness. However, if not, then we aren't exactly sure. If it's odd, it could be prime, since all primes are odd, or it could be one of the many composites which are odd, such as 9 or 15. And this massive region of odd composites makes for an unacceptable test. Now, to be clear, let's draw this. Provided some n can be either prime or composite. If n is prime, our algorithm will say prime 100% of the time, since no primes are even that are greater than 2. And it will never say composite when a prime is provided. However, if n is composite, our algorithm will say composite about 50% of the time and prime 50% of the time. So this means that if our algorithm outputs composite, it means it found proof, a composite witness. However, if our algorithm outputs prime, we know there is an unacceptably large chance of error. Up until now, our strategy has dealt with this large, unacceptably large error by iteration. And let's draw the flow of our machine. Given some n, our machine does a series of divisibility tests, starting at a is 2. It asks, does a divide n? And if it doesn't divide n, then we can eliminate all of this region. Then it asks the next question, does n divide 3? And if not, then we eliminate that whole section. And does n divide 5, 7, and so on. And notice these are disjoint sets which gradually fill up all possible composites. Now, if we ever answer yes along the way, then we have proof that n is composite. And A, whatever it is at that point, is our witness. So we halt and output composite from our algorithm. Otherwise, we continue trying until we exhaust all possible composites, until we hit the square root of n. Since we know, remember, every composite number n must have a factor less than or equal to the square root of n. So this really leads to the final question in our algorithm. If no witnesses are found and a is greater than the square root of n, then we suddenly have proof and we halt and output prime. So realize we have two exit paths through our algorithm. Both paths represent proof of certainty that n is either prime or composite. And when n is prime, we try all possible divisors and we basically rule them all out. And that is our proof that n is prime. The problem with this strategy is that our test value a at minimum requires us to cycle through every prime, starting from 2 to the square root of n. So as n grows, the number of primes grow with it. It results in too many iterations in the worst case, such as when we provide a prime to our algorithm. Looking at the big picture now, realize it's providing proof when n is prime, which we now know we don't exactly need. No one said we needed to prove it. We just needed to be 99.9999159% certain. So we actually need to think about the composite test that's being used in our algorithm. Remember, our fastest trial division primality tests thus far have tried to use prime patterns such as 6k, or all primes are of the form 6k plus or minus 1, to help walk along the primes only and eliminate many of the composites to save time. And remember, a test like this can be turned into a composite test. That is, given some integer n is of the form 6k plus or minus 1, then we could say it's probably prime, but there are many composites still which follow this pattern. It doesn't include primes only, just all primes and some composites. And we can think of these extra composites as a leak, and this leak is our source of error. Now, if we invert it and ask, is n not of the form 6k plus or minus 1? Then we can say with 100% certainty it is composite. So the leak is our source of error on the prime side. But in this case, it's unacceptable. It's not a non-negligible error. There's a much larger probability. We need to define a new composite testing procedure, which is able to shrink this space and make the chance of error negligible. Which means we'll need to review how we can actually shrink errors with iterations. I think we should now post our ideas below regarding, not what kind of tests might we want to perform, and also, more importantly, how could a random number generator really help us?